know, I didn't want people to get the idea I was trying to show I've matured, you know, because maturity is like a dangerous word, you know. What I wanted to do more was just do things that I've always done but never done on record, you know. So, sing more, do some more melodic singing, which doesn't even mean soft singing, you know, it just means more emphasis on melody. And I don't know, I think I've done a lot, you know, to broaden my scope. And I think everybody that's ever been into us is going to enjoy it. But then on top of that, I think there's a whole new audience. Well, the one person that I've used on everything besides myself is Bob Kulick, who's been a friend of mine for about 6 years. Actually, he tried out for Kiss. And right now he's in Meatloaf. And he, before that, did a tour with Alice Cooper and was in Lou Reed's group. He's a great guitar player. And I used him on everything. I used, on a couple of cuts, the bass player from Meatloaf, Steve Buslow. And on a couple of cuts, I used Richie Fontana, who used to be in Piper. I used him on drums. On some other cuts, I used a guy, Eric Nelson, on bass, who plays with Nick Gilder now. And I used Craig Cramp, who's a drummer for Nick Gilder now. He used to be in Flo and Eddie. And before that, he was in The Robs. I used him on some stuff. And then on some other stuff, one track I had Carmine play on. And a friend of mine, Pepe Castro, sang with me on some of the stuff. Pepe was in the Blues Magoos, and he's doing some great stuff out here now in L.A. And a friend of his, Doug Gling, Katsaros, great name. He's plays piano and sings on some stuff. Bob and I have been working together for about 5 or 6 years. I've been fooling around playing with Bob since I've known him. And he and I play very, very well together, so he knows exactly the way I think. So that was easy. Still to walk into a studio and see a whole different band than the guys I'm used to is very interesting, very strange at first. But more what I was looking for was people that were on the same wavelength as I was, so that without too much, you know, talking, I could get them to play what I wanted. I didn't think I should sit down and tell anybody note for note what to play. I thought that I should be able to direct them, but that the ideas had to be similar to begin with. You know, the musicians had to be thinking the same approach as I was. So it was actually very refreshing to work with different people. Very, very, very interesting. And I can only grow from things like that.
Yo, 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 welcome to the 18th episode of the Sinkin' Wang Show. In case you didn't know, my name is Bill Wang, and I am here with my co-host, El Cinco de Stanley. Sinkin' Stanley, bam!
Sinkin' Stanley here, people, and listen! Ha, 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 we got a great one for you this week, don't we, Bill?
Yeah, we sure do, brother man. It's going to be fucking fabulous, dude. And before we get to it, I just want to make a very quick announcement. I was going to make it at the end of the podcast, but I want to do it early. As everybody knows, Mark St. John's sister and myself have been becoming very good close friends. And long story short, Mark St. John's sister is going to do the Kiss Animalize episode with me and Sinkin' Stanley. We got her book to do her brother's Animalize. Now, by my calculations, that's about, you know, 7 or 8 albums down the line. So we're going to do it. By my calculations, it'd be sometime in the summer. Depends on how fast we spit out these episodes. So, yeah, man. So what I'm Sinking Stanley can't do it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to South Lake Tahoe, and we're going to do the Sinking Wang show with Mark St. John's sister.
Oh my God.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, you, I figured, you heard it here first, folks.
You're damn right it did. So that's about, you know, let's see. That's about, I guess, 7 albums ahead. So maybe sometime in August or something. So stay tuned. We're really looking forward to it. And she's a sweetheart. And, you know what I'm saying? So, hey, man. So here's the deal. We're now in the middle of our doing our Kiss solo album reviews, which has been fabulous and fun. But right now we are into the third one. And here's the deal. I want Sinking Stanley to tell you what that is, and why don't you go in and tell us what you think about the first song, your experiences, and what other crazy shit Sinking Stanley has on his mind. Bam!
Oh, man, Sinking Stanley, we're going to do the Paul Stanley 1978 solo album. Oh, man. This was produced by Paul Stanley and Jeff Glicksman. Those of you who aren't familiar with Jeff Glicksman, hey, Wang, are you familiar with Jeff Glicksman?
Well, to be honest with you, I was not aware of him until I started doing extensive research for the Sinking Wang show, but holy shit.
Oh, holy, wow.
Yeah, man, he's been part. Obviously, he got to start with Kansas and whatnot, but then a lot of metal. And yeah, to answer your question, I really am. And one thing I found interesting is that he was the producer of the Yngwie J. Malmsteen's 1988 Odyssey record.
Heck yeah, with Joe Lynn Turner.
Exactly. The one that they tried to go more commercial. I love that album. I don't care about any jackass bitch's opinion of it. I dig it. So to answer your question, brother man, yeah, man, I was very impressed by the lineage of all his production credits.
Oh, yeah.
Fabulous, dude.
Yeah, man. And another great album cover, you know, painted by, Araldo Rivera or whoever it was. You know?
Yeah, that's man. Tough for my boy.
He's awesome, man. And before we get started on the first track, man, we got to give it up for Bob Kulick, man. Bob Kulick is all over this thing. So I'm going to be giving him major props, man. So yeah, man, that first song, Tonight You Belong to Me. Oh, my God, dude.
Talk to me, Sinking Stanley. Talk to me.
Awesome, dude, man. What a beautiful slow start intro. Man, he's singing in that falsetto voice. It sounds just incredible, man. It's just fuck so yeah, awesome, man. And Bob Kulick guitar solos, man. And I gotta say, why was this not a single? What the fuck? I'm gonna have a few what the fuck moments during this episode. And here's the first one right off the bat. Why was this not a single? This could have been a hit. Wang, back to you, man. What's your thoughts?
Yeah, you know, very valid observation. It's a brilliant fucking classic song. And the fact that it opens up the fucking record, holy fucking hard on. I mean, badass, as I've said ad nauseum. I mean, you know, it's just an overview. September 18th, 1978. Only Kiss 78 solo album with all original songs. Interesting. New York Electric Lady, Record Plant, L.A. Village Recorder, where it was recorded. Like you said, Paul Stanley and Jeff Glicksman. Number 40 on the Billboard charts. Number 40. Wow. Yeah, and remember, if you go at the albums, Gene Simmons, for some reason, is number 22. Ace Frehley was number 26, which is very mind-blowing because he's the only guy that had a hit single. So that's a little bit of a head-scratcher. Paul Stanley went number 40, and if I'm not mistaken, Peter Criss number 43. But yeah, man, Tonight You Belong to Me. It's so majestic and powerful and so fucking amazing. And just a caveat, I saw the Paul Stanley 1989 solo tour Sunday, April 2nd, 1989. at the Omni in beautiful, crime-free Oakland, California. And
awesome.
Yeah, even in 1989, that was the crackhead situation. Not like it is now, but anyways, amazing memories and a great venue. I saw Sabotage there on the Gutter Valley tour. But and on this Paul Stanley tour, Sunday, April 2nd, 1989, the local band that I was fond of, Vicious Rumors, opened up. So,
wow. You know,
and just another little side note, I also saw the very week compared to this solo tour, November 13th, 2006, at the Fillmore, probably like four blocks west from where I'm right now. No wow. comparison, but still cool. Played some cool songs, you know. So I just wanted to say that. So, Sinkin' yeah. Stanley, talk to me about the second song. Move On. Tell me about Move On, brother man.
Oh, hey. man. Real quick, though. Vicious Rumors just finished up a tour with Raven.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, they did. They're still out there doing it, bro.
Oh, man. That's so cool. Fucking Digital Dictator was my fucking shit. Bam.
Wow. Move on, man. Oh, man. I can't stand this. I can't stand this song. I never liked it. And it figures this is the one that they played live on the Dynasty tour. Again, what the fuck, man? Why did they? It has some good guitar solos, though. But why did they play this instead of Tonight You Belong to Me? Or one of these other great songs coming up. They had to play like one of the weakest songs on the album, man. Oh my God. I could care less about this song, man. I kind of skip it almost every time I play the album. Yeah, Move On. Wang, what's your thoughts, man, of Mama setting Paul down on her knee, man?
Oh my God, that's fucking brutal. You know what? I kind of copy and paste what you just said. Not exactly a shining moment on the record. By all means, not let's put the sex in X.
it's filler, man. It's a filler track.
X and sex. So, anyways, and I have to say this, dude. And I made reference to the last episode about the Dynasty, Lakeland, Florida. You know, I made reference to that one bootleg guy. I'm sure I saw it. But anyways, I know for a fact the Move On, the best thing about it is the Ace solo at Lakeland, Florida. I dig it. Ace Frehley just looks all fucking just, oh, man, it's badass. So the song on the record, does it suck? No. But is it great? No. And like I said, not to repeat myself, but the solo on the Dynasty tour in Largo, so badass. So, all right. So, what's your take on number three? Ain't quite right.
Really quick, with one more thing, I move on, man. Something noticed. I've been watching and listening to a lot of demos on YouTube. You know, like not demos, bootlegs. And I noticed towards the end of the Dynasty tour, they started dropping the solo songs, the solo album songs, and. Yeah. Like by mid tour towards the end, the only two songs they were playing from the solo albums were New York Groove and Move On. And we know what happened after there, because you sure as hell didn't hear him play Move On the reunion tour, now did you?
No, you sure as fuck didn't. Sinkin' Stanley. Sinkin' D. Stanley.
But you know what song you heard from the solo albums on the reunion tour, don't you?
The song that went number 14 on the Billboard pop charts?
Yeah!
New York Groove! Bam, bam, bam! Dilly-dee! Dilly-dee!
That's right, man! New York Groove!
Yeah.
There was no Paul Stanley solo songs on that reunion tour.
No, they got no to that.
All right.
No way, Jose. So back to Ain't Quite Right. Bob Pulick, good shit, man. What do you think about this chill song? Tasty guitar solos and whatnot.
Ain't quite right. It ain't quite right, man. I still dig it. It's a cool song. He's got Pepe Castro doing backup vocals on it.
I read that.
Yeah. It's a little left field, you know, some light 70s rock.
What the
fuck? It's got some killer guitar solos, though. It's a cool tune to listen to if you're driving around, you know.
Or smoking a big fat joint.
Yeah, man. You know what it kind of reminds me of, too? I don't know if you ever listened to the first David Gilmour solo album.
No, I haven't.
Yeah, well, anyway, it kind of reminds me of that kind of stuff, you know?
I'm not adverse to listening to it. I think the only, not to get on another tangent, the only Pink Floyd solo album that I got into in a contemporary sense was, remember that Roger Waters album, something about hitchhikers?
No.
All right, well, you know, it's fucked up. Obviously, I'm not a professional, but there's this one Peter, I'm not really familiar with any of the Pink Floyd solo shit, so I'll have to check that shit out, dude.
So what do you think ain't quite right?
I kind of said it when my lead off to you. It's a chill song, tasty guitar solo, presumably the late, great Bob Kulick. It's a good song, man. I really liked it. Doing extensive research on this project of ours, I listened to the Paul Stanley solo a lot the last week, man. Got rediscovered with it and really found it a very, very, just a tasty album. And this song. Yeah. And this is a chill song. This is kicking back after work. You know, the fire's going, the middle of winter, you got a fucking, I like the vibe. I like the chill aspect. You know, Paul Stanley he's got a line of like 50 hot bitches ready to suck his dick when he wishes it was, you know, in and out, Sean Delaney. But anyways, that's another story altogether. That's coming from a jealous bitch. I know Paul Stanley gets so much pussy, but there's a little bit of, you know, confusion there. So anyways.
Yes, there is.
Yeah.
Something ain't quite right.
yeah, no pun intended. And then we go to number four. Wouldn't You Like to Know Me? As far as I'm concerned, it's another good song. If I'm being honest, to tell you the truth. Bam.
All right, man.
What do you think, Sink and Stanley?
Man, I got something to say about this one in a minute.
Well, tell us what you got to say. You're sneaking Stanley.
Okay. This is my favorite song on the album. This is awesome.
Cool. I know.
This is like pop perfection. I mean, why was this not the single? This would have been a hit, bro.
No, dude.
This could have been a hit song. I don't get it, man. What the fuck? Here, you know, I'm gonna go ahead and give a little exclusive here. Sink and Stanley.
We need some sort of update theme. Bam, 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 bam. Update. Sink and Stanley. Go.
I'm not gonna let the cat out of the bag totally, but Wang, you know who I know. You know, I'm in the circles, and I'm trying to make something very special happen. I'm giving it my all.
I know what you're talking about.
I am recording a very straight up cover of this song, I'm trying to get it to the powers to be, because Ace Frehley's next solo album is going to be a duets album. And better to do a duet of a Paul Stanley 1978 solo tune than Sink and Stanley doing Wouldn't You Like to Know Me with Ace Frehley on guitar.
Oh my God, amazing. The world awaits, CNN awaits, MSNBC, God, Fox News. You're going to be on all the fucking shit, dude.
Is it going to happen? Probably not.
What the fuck's all this negativity horseshit, dude?
Could it happen?
Yeah.
It's possible.
Well, let's be positive. Optimism will run the day. Hey, before I get to the number five song, Take Me Away, Together as One, I want to read something.
Okay.
I want to read something from this book that I got a long time ago. It's called Kiss Behind the Mask, the official authorized biography with David Leith and Ken Sharp. I've never heard of David Leith, but I've heard of Ken Sharp. He's like a very prominent author in the Kiss world, like sort of on the same level, Julian Gill, mastermind of Kiss FAQ. Anyway, so check this shit out, dude. So I believe this book came out in 2003. So here's Gene Simmons. What's cool about this is it has all these analysis of certain songs from all the members, the behind-the-scene people and whatnot. It's quite fascinating. So Gene Simmons wrote, Paul's solo album was a lot closer to the Kiss thing, but the solo record I enjoyed most was Ace Frehley's. I thought that was a lot more rock and roll spirit, and I liked the guitars on it. When Paul sticks to the harder edge lyrics, I like it more. But there's a lot of stuff on there that's the leaves are, I can't see, so I'm, it's the leaves are covering up the light of the sunlight. So with Paul sticks to the harder edge, I like it more. And then he writes, I like it more, but there's a lot of stuff on there that's love this, love that, when you like to know me, hold on, hold me, touch me, kind of stuff. When Paul starts to get romantic, I turn off. But when a rock and roller, you can't touch him. So as long as he stays hard, it works for me. But when he goes soft, I miss you. I love you. I miss you. I go, you're spineless. Go away. Two stars.
Funny. Funny. So, Sean Delaney had the same quote.
Well, here's the deal. Well, I don't know. There's no Sean Delaney quote on the Paul Stanley album. There is on the Peter Criss album. I wish I had his last episode. But, yeah, Ace Frehley gives the Paul Stanley solo album 5 out of 5 stars. So,
wow.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, so I had to do that. So, all right, so you know what? I want you to take this one. Sinkin' Stanley.
All right, number 5.
Hold on, let me properly announce you. El Cinco de Stanley, Oslo Mas Grande. Bam.
Oh, yeah, man. Take me away.
Take me away together as one. Bam.
Oh, man, dude, what an epic track with Carmen Appice on drums, man.
Holy crap, dude.
You know, it's another left field song, but it works, man. And yeah. And Carmine's going off on those drum fills at the end, man. What an epic track. There's a band called Lucifer out there that does it with a chick singer that does a killer little cover of it. Check that out. But yeah, man, I love this song, man. What do you think, Wayne?
I mean, and that's just a caveat. You made reference to the Lucifer song. I did hear that. It's very interesting. No doubt. But the song, I have very simplistic situation. I did make reference to Carmen Appice on drums. So that's kind of cool. Right around the time he played on Do You Think I'm Sexy? I believe that's the next year in 79, if I'm not mistaken. Maybe I'm wrong.
Yeah, he even got a co-write for that song, I think.
Yeah, no shit. I saw that, dude. But it's Take Me Away Together one is so grandiose, so ambitious, so bold, just so I have the cock and you want to suck it mentality. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, man. Don't say that too often around Mr. Stanley.
All right, number 6, It's All Right. What a great opener for side 2, flipping it over on the old LPs. Back in the old days where all the grandpas, now all the young kids, Gen Z and the young versions of millennials, because the old millennials are almost Gen X, so they're kind of an our age group. But, oh, man, what a great opener of side 2. I like it. I wish... Not to be a spoiler alert, I wish this would have ended the album, and not to be presumptuous or not presumptuous. No, I'm not a big fan of the last song on this record. I think this would have been fabulous. So what is your take on It's All Right, number 6, side 2, leading off El Cinco de Stanley, Oslo Mas Grande, bam, 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 bam.
It's all right, man. Exactly. Oh. It's all right. It's all right. It's a good song. It's not a favorite of mine. However, this could have been on. This is the song that could have been on a Kiss album. To me, this is the most Kiss sounding song on the entire album. And Yeah, man, this could have been on Love Gun for all, you know. Why not? Yeah.
That's a very thought-provoking statement. I hadn't really thought of that as far as the context of where it could have belonged, because us Kiss fans are so anal. Well, this song should have been on here and this and that. But that's a very good observation, and I buy that. Yeah, that's a Love Gun song.
Could have been a leftover. Could have been a leftover.
Yeah, exactly, dude. Yeah. Exactly. All right, so let's go to the big hit.
And I
say that in air quotes. Number 46 on the pop charts. The song gets abused throughout the years. It's totally gets trolled, including myself. I've ripped it like to no end. But you know what, man? The more I'm thinking about it, and now that I'm like almost 90 years old, I don't think it's so bad, because here's one of the reasons. I heard the song literally on the radio. There was a radio station in Livermore, California, Tri-Valley, that I don't know if it's still around now, but it was called KKIQ. And they played this song a lot, and I called in a lot, and dilly-dee. And you know what, man? I'm going to do a 180. Do I love it? No. But you know what? I do not hate it like I did, you know, when I was a young kid. So, I don't know. What's your take on Hold Me, Touch Me, number 46 pop chart?
Awesome. Hold Me, Touch Me, man. Oh, dude. I freaking love it, man. I ain't going to lie. I love it, man. I'm a sucker for a good gay song, bro.
Oh, I know. You're all gay, dude. That's why I love you, brother.
There's nothing wrong with it, man. Hey, whatever floats your boat.
Exactly.
Paul played all guitars. He brought in his buddy Pepe Castro to do a little bit of backing vocal. It's got a great emotional guitar solo by none other than Paul Stanley himself. But again, another what the fuck moment was he thinking about making this the lead and the only single?
I don't know, dude.
Hear me out. I get it. You know, he was going for the Barry Men I Blow freaking thing. You know, Barry Men I Blow was all over the radio at that time. You know, he had Mandy written about Randy and Even Now and Weekend in New England. And, you know, that shit was all over the radio. So Paul was trying to get him a Barry Men I Blow hit, I guess, you know. So, and not that there's anything wrong with that, man. I love a little bit of Barry Men I Blow, man. I mean, he did write the songs that I sing, you know, the whole world sings.
Hey, hold on.
Why?
No, feel me, brother, man. Dilly D, ba 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 ba. Where did Barry Manilow write that song that you just made reference to? I write the song. There was a specific location that he wrote that song. Do you remember the location?
Well, judging by you asking me that question, I assume that he wrote that song in San Francisco.
Good guess. Very close. He wrote it at the Copacabana. At the Copa. Yeah, so there you go. There's a little, you know, insider information for all our fans. So there you go. Bam.
Hey, man, and before we get off Hold Me, Touch Me, make sure you go and listen to my parody song of Hold Me, Touch Me, Won't You Touch Me? Oh yeah, wow. Man, it's there on the Sinkin' Stanley YouTube channel.
Hey, if I don't ask you for much, my brother, but my girlfriend's probably going to be watching this because I love her so. Can you sing that once more?
Hold me, tell me, won't you touch me?
Holy shit. Holy shit.
When we're apart.
Da, 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 go. No, keep going.
Oh, no, that's it.
That was beautiful, brother, man. You are da, 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 ba, 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 bam, the man. Hey, man, what's your take on number 8? Love in Chains.
Oh, dude, Love in Chains. Oh, dude, it's so freaking rocking, man. What an awesome rocking, chugging riff. I love this song. Again, Bob Kulick all over the place. Amazing, killer little guitar theme intro, you know, solo intro, and just solos all over the place, man. Oh, dude, Love and Chains, man. This song freaking rips, dude. Freaking love it, man. Love it. Love it.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Man, the song has lots of energy. Cool solo. I have no problem with the song. You know, is it great? Yeah. No. But does it suck? Fuck no, it doesn't.
Hell no, it don't suck.
It's a kick-ass rocker, diddly dee. Ba-ba-ba, 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 bam!
Bam! Oh, yeah. Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Well, man, it's about time to say goodbye.
Oh, man, I'm ready to cry like a little fucking bitch.
Oh, man, it's over. The last song, man.
Yeah, I know, dude. I know, man. What's your take on the last song? Goodbye.
Dude, I love it. 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 Killer riff. Here's the thing, too. Paul Stanley wrote all of these songs. There's only a couple that another guy helped him write, man. Paul's usually not the one to write a good guitar riff. He'll write a good melodic song with, you know, strumming chords and whatnot. But, you know, usually it was always Gene and Ace with the guitar riffs, you know. Right. But he's got a couple really good guitar riffs on this album. And this is one of them, man. Goodbye's got a killer guitar riff. I cannot say enough about Bob Kulick and all the great soloing, man. I mean, and shortly after this, Bob was playing with frickin' Diana Ross doing the Why Do Fools Fall in Love and Mirror Mirror. That was Bob Kulick, bro.
Wow.
I mean, holy cow, dude. Goodbye. Yeah. Goodbye, man. And check out the Thinking Wang parody song. Dubai. Oh, not goodbye, but Dubai. Will they ever get their Dubai packages? I don't know. I don't think so.
You are a commercial slut talking about your music.
Hey, that's why
I love you. Sing it, stand.
Hey, man. Ain't anybody else going to care? Ain't anybody else going to care?
Well, I beg to differ, homeboy. A lot of people care, man. You are singing Stanley, motherfucker. But, yeah, man.
What do you think of goodbye, Wang?
What's that?
What do you think of goodbye?
I kind of jumped the gun. I don't like it, dude. Yeah, man, I don't like it. Do I hate it? No, I just don't like that. Da 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 da.
I just don't like that.
Mommy, why da 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 ba da 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 ba 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 ba.
What about that opening riff, man? That one.
All right. There are elements that are cool, but generally speaking, I'm just not down it, dude.
Whatever, man. We all, hey, man. It's all good.
Yeah, but overall, this album, hold on, I just kicked the thing out. Overall, it's sick as fuck, it's awesome. I think the cool thing is to rip this album. A lot of popular podcasters I've noticed that have a thing for this shit, because, and here's my take on that, because of the Scab Kiss element, because of what Paul Stanley became. But I think when you're reviewing this album and all these solo albums, what I'm guilty of, I'm listening to these and making the reviews on the Sinking Wang show in the context of today, not back then. Like, for instance, my girlfriend's all, man, you didn't really talk about how much you hated the Peter Kirst album back when you were a little kid. Well, I made a couple references. Maybe I should have made a more forceful presentation, how I thought that album was horrific and apocalyptic and, you know, I wanted to light my hair on fire as a little kid.
Wow. But,
yeah, you know what I'm saying? On the real, you know what I'm saying? On the real. But, man, in 2024 context, I think these albums are very fucking thought-provoking and interesting. And
they are.
I really, really love it. You know, we forgot to make reference when we're talking about this year, the great year of 1978, the year of our Lord. The second Kiss comic book for Marvels came out, I believe it was August 15th of 1978. So So another, you know, thing to add on to the legacy of 1978. Do you remember that, dude?
Oh, I remember. I remember it all coming out, man. 1978, they were coming out with all kinds of shit, man.
Yeah.
I mean, golly, man. They were merchandising like crazy between 77 and 79, man.
Yeah.
Seemed to be like Kiss everywhere, man. It was awesome.
No shit, dude. Obviously, everybody, our next episode is going to be by far the best of the solo records. But God damn it, Paul Stanley is, without question, by far the second best. Am I right? Yeah.
What's your top three off this album, Wang?
I'll let
you think about it for a second. I'll give you my top three.
Yeah, go for it, brother, man.
My number one song, I already gave that away. Wouldn't You Like to Know Me? Number two, Tonight You Belong to Me. And number three, Goodbye, your favorite song, man. That's my third favorite song on this album, bro.
Right. My number one would be Tonight You Belong to Me. Number two would be Take Me Away Together is one. And number three would be It's All Right. Bam!
Awesome, man. Nothing wrong with that. Shit.
For sure.
And once again, Wang, we got to tell these lazy fuckers to get in there and join the Sinkin' Wang Facebook group. If you're not a member of the Sinkin' Wang Facebook group, what are you waiting for? Come on, man.
Yeah, you know. Yeah.
Join that sucker so we can start having some fun in there, man. We need some people.
Hold on. I'm having fun in there right now. It's just unfortunately only 14 people can see me.
Well, there's 21 of us in there, but you know.
Oh, right on, cool. But yeah, we're doing good. Thankfully, the episodes aren't bombing. The Gene Simmons didn't do so good. But man, I'm gonna be honest. I was surprisingly satisfied that our last episode that went up less than 24 hours ago, Peter Crisp, is doing pretty goddamn respectful, man. So right on. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. I appreciate that, everybody. Thank you.
Peter Criss kicked Gene Simmons' ass.
Big time. And so did Vinnie Vincent.
So did Vinnie Vincent. Poor Gene.
Go figure, dude.
Poor Gene, solo album. Nobody likes Gene's solo album. I love it.
I don't love it, but I like it. As I've said, I think both of us quite eloquently talked about the Gene album. I thought it was pretty good, man. So fuck it.
Yeah. Well, Wang, you got anything else?
No, man, I'm good, dude. I'm just looking forward to Mark St. John's sister to appear on the Kiss Animalize episode. By my calculations in my little brain, I think that would be, because I believe that's seven episodes ahead, because we got Ace Frehley next, we got Dynasty after that, we got Unmasked after that, we got Elder after that, we got Creatures after that, we got Lick It Up after that, and then we got Animalize, so that's number seven. So, you know, we're not banging shit out every week. Even though we've been doing really good, that's probably going to, seven episodes is going to probably take us until the end of August, right?
Probably.
Yeah, because I go back to Boston, I go back to Idaho. So, and I'm sure
maybe you've got maybe even longer. Who knows, man? If people don't start joining our Facebook group, man, I don't know, man.
Well, no, here's what I got. I have to fucking, I started us, you know, Facebook is like old people like us, but a media consultant, a friend of my lawyer's all, man, you need to go on Instagram, Dilly D, and there is a Sinkin' Wang Show 666 page on Instagram, and I've never posted anything on it, but I'm going to start building the Instagram page. Because, you know, there's a lot of people that are a lot younger than us that like our crazy shit. So I was told, dude, you're fucking, if you're stuck in Facebook, you know, your audience will be dead within 5 years. So what? I mean, that's it, Dilly D.
Out.
I know, dude. It was hard, man. But, you know, when you.
Brutal.
Yeah, brutal shit, dude. So El Cinco de Stanley, man. Awesome episode.
Buddy.
Fucking A, brother, man. Looking forward to, we have a plan for next week. We're going to do the Ace Frehley solo album. So what do you think? Tell everybody good night. Sinkin' Stanley.
Well, that's it for another episode of the Sinking Wang Show. We'll see you next time.
Bam! Do I want to put the makeup on and be, you know, baby tall? Like, fuck you.
This has been a Fake Arnie production.
Bam!